Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Nice truck. It's got a cane sticker.
Commissioner's bond?
Yeah.
I swear somebody's put it on a bond sticker.
Yeah, I seen that too. I wondered who that belonged to. Dan Engel's the one.
I want to welcome everyone to this morning's meeting. Before we get started, I'd like to ask Commissioner Engel if he would give us our invocation.
We'll call on Pastor Mark Mitchell, who's with us today from Carolina Christian Church. Pastor Mitchell.
Let's pray. Father, we do thank you for another glorious day to be on this earth. And God, I'm just grateful for the privilege to be able to serve you. And God, I pray for these men and women that are on this board. And I know, Lord, that the task that they've chosen to undertake as an occupation is an important one. And the decisions that they make affect the affairs of this county in which we live. God, I pray that you'd help them to have the wisdom to diligently decide on issues and matters that come before them. And God, I pray that your will be accomplished through them. We thank you for allowing us to be alive this day and to serve you. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Pastor.
The first item of business, we always start the meeting with public comments. And we have several that have signed up this morning. And if you would, we'd like you to limit your comments to about 3 minutes. We have them timed. First one who signed up is, I believe I can read the name, Eddie Hsu, maybe?
Yes.
Eddie Hsu, Mr. Hsu.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, Commissioner.
Good morning. Good morning.
I believe I can get my point across in 3 minutes. I gave you a little handout, pretty well summarizes what I want to do, accomplish this morning. But I want to approach it in a way that maybe you hadn't heard before. All right, perception. Now, we hear that 287G is saving us money, social service, whatnot, and all. We all know what the short list is. We hear Alamance County is on the short list for ABCD industry. What about people? The long list is the one we never see, the one we never hear about. That's where they sit there and somebody has researched Alamance County as a potential site business or whatever. And the comments, these actions that we see, the stuff in the papers, true or not, they certainly, some board member somewhere this morning could be sitting and saying, I don't want Alamance County reputation with this 287G program affecting my business. Let's just throw them to the side and not put them on the short list. I'm sure you can understand what I'm saying. We'll never know. We can't count the long list into the cost of 287G. No way, because we ain't going to know. They're not going to look. Come and tell you that we saw these comments in the News Observer. We saw them in Winston-Salem Journal. We saw them on a radical pro in a stopping immigration site, and we saw them on a radical non-pro website. They're not going to tell you. And so we can't count those costs into what 287G is costing. Now, about the kids. Now, if that story is true, then you'll see that I asked the sheriff, if true, it could be untrue. Do you remember a couple of years ago, the gentleman was stopped on 85, took into the jail, his buddy was left in the truck, but bam, somebody hit him. You remember that? If I wouldn't be standing here asking you to consider investigating anything if that had been those three kids, if this story was true. Those three kids have been sitting there, a truck or something smashed into them. We wouldn't be up here seeking, I wouldn't be here because it would be national news and we'd have to do something. So I asked him to consider putting your weight behind and asked the sheriff to look into it and inform the public, yay or nay. and I ask you to consider that maybe we want to look at how we approach it and use it more as a, as it was originally told us, to get the bad guys off the street, not just rent, you know, what has proceeded to be, you know, willing it. Yeah. That's all I'm asking.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Shue. Next to sign up is Brian Niehaus.
Hi, good morning. I see one familiar face, Dan Engel. I work at Elon University. I teach business. And I think I have an email exchange with Tim Sutton and maybe one phone conversation. My agenda for today is really simple. I wanted to come here, see the building, see all of you, and let you see me, because I suspect that as the next months unfold, I'll be coming back again, and so will a number of my associates. I can tell you that we had a meeting earlier this week, and I was surprised to see 50 people show up. I think it was in relation to this event that you spoke of, the rest of this young woman from the library. 50 people showed up, and I believe 46 of them were from the county. I've been a resident of the county since 1999. And and I think you're going to find two things. Number one, you may find that there is less support for 287G than you might suspect. And I think you're also going to find that the lack of support for 287G is going to endure over time. And so we'd like to, I know a number of us in the community who haven't been at these meetings before are probably going to come here just for the to sort of become a familiar face and share with you what we've learned about 287G and about the what I specifically specialize in is the economic impact of immigration on the county. And I believe I've shared some data with Mr. Sutton a few months ago based on my research, and I hope he'll share that with you, and if not, you know, I'd be happy to share it with the commissioners as well. But thanks for the agenda. This is a nice, I teach business communication, and it's nice to have an agenda before a meeting begins. I think it's a compliment to your audience. Thanks.
Okay.
Thank you.
Next is Bonko. Yes.
Good morning. I just wanted to introduce myself. My name is Blanca Sendejas Niehaus. I am Professor Niehaus's wife. I am from Mexico. Mm-hmm. I am a resident of Alamance County. Soon I will be an American, pretty soon, I hope. And I just wanted you to know my face, and I wanted to meet all of you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Appreciate it.
And Marilyn Tyler.
My name is Marilyn Tyler. I'm a resident of Burlington for 30 years. Ronald Reagan, George Bush, and John McCain have all advocated the creation of legal pathways to citizenship for the estimated 12 million undocumented aliens in our country. Michael Chertoff, head of the Department of Homeland Security, agrees, calling undocumented Latinos a distraction from the work his agency should really be doing, tracking real terrorist threats. Chertoff says you have about 7 million people working without legal documentation, and the rest are their dependents. Many of them are rooted here. They may have kids in school, and they've got jobs. If the employers fire these 7 million, who's going to do the work? And even if we could round up 1,000 people a week, that would only be about 50,000 a year. Do the math. How many years would it be? So my question to you folks, my friends, Tim and I have lived in the same neighborhood for 30 years. So why did the powers that be in our county decide to spend time and resources to pursue one little Mexican-born woman who grew up here, went to school here, got a part-time job at the library while she studied? Who turned Mojave Angel in? Four different reporters got four different stories. The SBI, somebody at the health department, an anonymous informer, a county employee. You folks are in a position to find out the truth and determine why someone thought it was important enough to make an example of this young woman and demolish six lives in the process. You folks can also find out why my friends at the public libraries are afraid to talk to me about Mojave Angel, why they have been threatened with disciplinary action or dismissal if they speak in support of her, why they tell me, and numbers of them have told me, I love Mojave, but I need this job. What has this county become that friends can't speak up for friends for fear of reprisal? I wish each of you had sat with me in the federal building in Winston-Salem and watched while federal marshals led Mojave into the room, completely swathed in chains. When her case finally came up 2 hours later, even the judge and the U.S. attorney expressed some surprise at her presence before them. Why this young woman, they intimated, when surely law enforcement could find some truly dangerous people to prosecute? Exactly. Why this woman? I hope you'll find out for us. I hope you look into Mojave's case and others that have been instigated under the 287G provision between the Sheriff's Office and Immigration and Customs. There are only a few of us here today, but standing behind each of us are dozens more, and we live in this country. We want to be proud of it and not ashamed, and we won't let this issue die.
I'm not sure I'm going to agree with it, but I'll read
it. It's a conservative view of why you should let immigrants in.
Next, Jose Alegria.
Alegria. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen.
Good morning.
Basically, just as my colleagues mentioned to you, I'm here in reference to of the 287G. I have been a resident of North Carolina, Alamance County, since I was a little kid. But I was brought here with my parents through that legal process and everything. But I just want you to keep in mind that maybe $1.50 or $3 of myself and my colleague have heard before, $3 out of these people is going to our taxes. It's paying for our roads. It's paying for many other things that they are paying with their money that they are gaining here in Alamance County. It is noticeable and it is understandable that our immigration laws are broken somewhere, and it is understandable that our Congress hasn't done anything in reference to it for quite some time. But I do believe that, as mentioned before, you, the ones who are sitting here, have the power to do something in reference to what is going on here in our county. It is a shame that those three children were left on the highway for a number of hours. And as mentioned before by the other gentleman, what if? What if is a huge question. Something would have happened to those to them. We, as the taxpayers, possibly may be facing a lawsuit by somebody, because it was negligence in reference from our elected officials. And the basic question is, what can we do? Ship them all out? Yes, we can. But when and how are we going to do this? Who is going to do the work that they are doing now? We have many people who are fixing our hamburgers. Are they legal? Only God knows. We have many staffing agencies who have been employing them for a number of years. Are they doing their job to find out whether they are legal or non-legal in the States or in Alamance County? I don't know. But I do know that what happened with Max Abbey, it is something that we cannot control. What happened and what is going on with our health department, only God knows what's going to happen. But we come before you to ask you to please look into this for our county and for our state, not to become what happened with the state of Arizona. 287G statewide, it is possible here in North Carolina. But a number of people, as mentioned before by Brian, came together on Thursday to see what we can do as a whole, as concerned citizens, in reference to the 287G, to what we can do for those undocumented individuals who are here trying to do something good. Yes, there are some bad apples out there, and we cannot fix that. But we can try to work with them to get those bad apples out of here, but try to work with the system and not against the system. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
That's all that's signed up on the list. Would anybody else like to speak? Sheriff, I hate you came in late. I'd like to say something. Let me say that I support the 287G because it only deals with the people who break the laws. And this country is made up of laws, not of people and politicians. The laws is the only thing difference in our system of government and other systems of government. If we're going to decide which laws are important and which laws aren't important, if you want to change the laws, fine. You need to get your congressman. The federal government is the ones that change those laws. They're the ones that pass those laws, and we are responsible to see that they are enforced. They're mandates to be enforced. And
the system is not broken. What is broken is the federal government not doing their job enforcing the borders. We have a borders that need to be enforced, and I say enforce the borders or change the laws.
Any other commissioner say anything?
Well, I think it's I hate to always keep talking about it, to be quite honest about it, but people won't let the process take its due course. The Center for Immigration Studies in Washington just released a report just this past week that millions of illegal immigrants have gone back because of the enforcement procedures that are taking place across the United States, not just here in this county. But their 287G is across the country, and a lot of people are being turned down for it. I think it's clear that the majority of the American people want something done. And we've taken it upon ourselves. I've fully supported what we're doing here. We've taken it upon ourselves to utilize the laws that are on the books federally to do what we're doing. And it's not slowing down. Just in yesterday's Raleigh News and Observer, there was an article, Dateline, the byline was from Charlotte. The Homeland Security Department has allowed Charlotte to become a pilot program, along with San Diego, Chicago, and a couple of other major cities, to say, okay, you've got X amount of days to get your stuff together, to get your money together, and we'll let you go back home. But if you don't do that, we're coming after you, basically, is what it said. Now, with all due respect to anybody that's caught in this process, whether it be somebody that works at a library, but would all the speculation and would all the commentary been what it's been if it had been a factory worker? If it had been somebody at McDonald's? No. What we've got here is an emotional outpouring based on sympathy. And that's, I understand that. But would that sympathy level have been what it is here if it had been a factory worker and so forth? I doubt it would even made the paper, to be quite honest about it. But I honestly do not think that enforcement is going to get softer. I think it's going to get stricter. And I'm all for doing what we're doing here, and I'm sure it does bother people. I'm sure it bothers people. I'm sorry that we've had to do it as a nation. But you say you have, that the outpouring of support might be less than what we think it is. The people who show up at your meetings, with all due respect, in Chapel Hill, I think you were at Chapel Hill, I think the professor was. Yeah, I think you were there. The people that show up at these meetings, naturally, they're all pro not doing anything. But I dare say that if you poll this county, the percentages of people who are happy with what we're doing, it would be 80%. I don't think there's any question about it. Here and across the nation. So I appreciate you coming, and I understand how you feel, but I understand how I feel.
Anybody else? Any board members?
Yeah, I'd like to comment. Like Mr. Sutton, I understand your feelings. And I remember one time coming from the coast up here and coming through Raleigh. And everybody was flying by me, and we were all doing above the speed limit. So I decided to go a little faster, but I was still in the very back of everybody. Here comes a state trooper. And who does he get but me? Well, I wasn't the guiltiest, if you want to put it that way, person. And I said, well, why'd you stop me? Everybody's going past me. And he said, but you were easy. I could catch you. Now, I'm not sure this is a situation here, but sometimes, you know, suppose it had been someone that was a rapist or a murderer, you know, we wouldn't even be discussing this. I do believe in the rule of law, and we are a nation of laws. And we can't pick and choose what laws we enforce and what laws we don't enforce. And that's where I really have to stand. And she may be a wonderful person. I only wish that she had started the process of becoming a citizen or doing what she needed to do to be here. That's what I'm going to say.
Dan, you got anything?
Can we respond to that at all?
Sure, I guess.
This might answer your question. One of the problems is, and Bill has touched on it, several of you folks have touched on it before, this country's turned upside down in regards to immigration laws. And when a person comes here illegally, the U.S. Supreme Court said, well, hey, they have a right to go to school, which the young lady did this 12 years. She went through the school here, did very well. Teachers take the time and build a rapport and do the best they can in teaching them. Yet, once she comes out of the school system, she is still an illegal immigrant. She's an illegal alien. And what does she do? Well, she's obtained a fictitious Social Security card from a dead person. She's violated numerous laws, and she ends up in jail. The problem still lies with the federal government, and that's the point I'm trying to make here. Did she get caught up in the 287G program? Yes. Is the 287G program a good problem? A good program? Again, yes. Bob, that was a slip of the tongue. Yes, it is. It's not a problem. It is a good program. It has made the streets in this state much safer as it is as our great nation, and we need to continue with that program. Do we have serious problems with immigration? Yes. Where can they be fixed? Only one place, and that is with the federal government.
May I say one more sentence, please? It's a disservice to her as an individual to take her monies for Social Security knowing she'll never get a penny of it. That's a disservice to her. It's also a disservice to her to let her live her whole life in this country, assuming that nothing would be changed, knowing that she'll go to prison if she applied for a credit card. The FBI would be called in. She could go to jail just for that, for credit. You know, it's a federal offense to put false information on a credit application. It's a disservice to her not to go ahead, and to anybody else in this situation, not to go ahead and remedy the situation as it now stands, and then hope the future is better for them.
Well, I think we will have some federal action, no matter who the next president is, because both candidates favor fixing the immigration issue, just as President Bush did, but had an unwilling Congress. Basically, the Republicans blocked everything. I think you might see a change in Congress in this next election. I prefer Republicans not lose seats, but I think they're going to lose seats, and I think there's probably going to be enough change that they can get a reasonable immigration law passed that will give the young lady that worked at the library a chance to become a citizen instead of being deported. I agree with Mr. Hsu that spoke earlier that this has been a huge blackout in Alamance County. Business people looking at Alamance County is going to have a different attitude, I think, because of the children being left in the car and the library. Now, sheriff was following the procedure, but to me it was bad judgment, especially on the children. And I hate it for the young lady at the library. I wish I could do something to keep her here. And I think our 287G program has gotten out of control in the aspect. I think the sheriff's office is targeting people for minor violations, and probably sending them name and so forth over to the INS people when he stood before us earlier and said he wouldn't do that. But I'm highly upset with what's been going on. I don't know if you saw the article in the Greensburg paper yesterday, but these are very derogatory articles that's appearing in the state's largest newspapers. And I hate it. The light is put in our county. An investigation at the health department, investigation at social services, I think it's been, especially one at social services, and her travel, checking her travel. I mean, all of this I think is way out of bounds. And I'm highly upset with it. And I know a majority of our board supports Susan Osmond and the job you're doing, Susan.
The majority have told me personally that they support you, and I want to publicly let you know that. Okay, that ends the public comment section.
Well, I have to respond to our chairman's comment. Now, this isn't an immigration debate, but it's the softness on this issue that you're espousing that has caused the problem to become what it's become.
Well, you got to come to a reasonable solution, and Congress hadn't seemed to be able to come to a reasonable solution. And I think when, I hate to say it, but more Democrats elected, they're going to come to a reasonable solution with a Republican president at the helm. And they'll work together to get something done. Next is a very enjoyable item on the board agenda this morning. It's a presentation of an award. Phyllis Green is going to make that. Phyllis?
Good morning, Mr. Smith and Commissioners. Excuse my voice. It's a pleasure this morning to come before you and to be part of presenting an award that is surely long overdue. The recipient of this award is a World War II veteran, and he's a true veterans advocate, not only for the veterans of Alamance County, but in other counties as well. He is an avid supporter of the Alamance County Veterans Service Office, and for many years has been active in local service organizations and continues to do so even in poor health. He has served on the Veterans Service Board in Alamance County for over 30 years. It is an honor and a privilege to present the award today to Mr. Nick Collins and Mr. Sharp as Chairman of the Board of Alamance County Commissioners. Would you present this award?
I'll be delighted.
This is the highest award to an individual of North Carolina. It's the Order of the Longleaf Pine, signed by Governor Mark Wilson.
Gives you all the rights of an ambassador extraordinary, privilege to enjoy all rights granted to members of the Exalted Order, among which is a special privilege to propose the following North Carolina toast to select company anywhere in the free world. Here's to the land of the longleaf pine, the summer land where the sun doth shine, where the weak grow strong and the strong grow great. There's to down home the old North State. Michael Easley, dated August the 4th, 2008. Congratulations.
I'm going to stand where I'm at so I won't fall. And speak loud enough, if you can't hear me, you hold your hand up and I'll see if I can help you. I wouldn't be here today if it wasn't for my judge sitting there as attorney and county manager, Mr. David Smith. I joined the help for the veterans 63 years ago by accident. When I came home, I was in bad shape, and they had a doctor ready for me and told me to report to the third floor of the First National Bank building downtown. Well, I was at home there with my mother. I don't know whether my sister answered the phone or what took me to come up there. So I went up there, and when I opened the door and went in, they sent them to World War One old time forming a veterans organization. And I looked over there and I said, "Where's Dr. Bo Harper's office at?" And they said, "Next door." So I went up there, and Dr. Bo Harper had my papers and told me that I had a long life to travel. Miserable. That's the exact words he told me. So I said, "Well, I'll do the best I can." So consequently, he told me that report back he needed me and all for my service-connected disability, that he would be right there for me, which I had seen a lot of that. So anyway, I went back in there
And they told me they were forming this Veterans Committee. So I said, well, I want to help y'all if I can. So I've been involved in the Veterans Service Office for 63 years. Because that's all the time I had to do. And if it wasn't for the judge, Your Honor, I wouldn't be here today. I came down here and visited practically all the head people that are working for the county, like the judge is, and they all turned their back on me. I'll be perfectly frank with you. I ain't gonna call no names. So I kept on. We were treated like orphans. We were in the building up there trying to get work to be convenient for people to come downstairs and trying to find a parking place. And finally, we got a place, and that became controversial. So if it hadn't have been, then I stuck with it and tried to help them where I could. Well, we hired a little lady, which is to be credited to this day, and she, I had met her through accident. And she said she was working for Jesse Kingsland, getting up laundry, and decided that she wanted to be a secretary. And so she went to work boarding hose at May Hoser Mill at night so she could go to Burlington Day School. Well, she turned out to be a jewel for 35 years in the county. But the only disappointment that she had, and I don't mind telling all of you, is she asked her supervisor, could she get a little raise? And he said, well, I don't even know what you do. She said, you've never been in the veterans office to know what we do. And I hate to say it, but at her retirement, they punished her 50% of what she should be getting. She was with us 35 years. So it's always something. She didn't tell me about 5 years later. If I had known it in time, I would have put some brush on it. But this is the reason that I'm standing here today, due to Judge Smith over there, that he took time out to go over to the office and see what it was all about. And I appreciate the award, and I appreciate being here. And any questions anybody wants to ask me, I'll be glad to answer. And our girls, now make me forget my girls down there. We got the best service office in the state of North Carolina. We had all kinds of awards, tops, because they got the education for it, they got the schooling for it, and they've taken time to look after the veterans. And I might say this, the one I'm speaking about. When she came to work for us, I told Jesse Kingsland, I said, you better hire her, she's a good one. And she turned out to be a jewel. She had a Royal typewriter, and she could take shorthand. And veterans would come in there and she'd take it all down. And then she'd have to sign a piece of paper so they could go on about the business and get the next one. Then she would type it in the typewriter and send it to the proper places. And she stuck with us through thick and thin for 35 years. And I don't want to forget her and forget these girls either. They do a top flight job.
They do, Nick. You got family with you this morning?
Yes, I sure have. This is my daughter here. And this is my baby sister. And that's my baby boy. My brother-in-law standing back here watching. And it's been an honor being with y'all. Hope I didn't buzz you too much. There's a lot I could say is that I'm thankful for what we have here. And the Veterans Office would always be. There'd always be wars, and they'd try to close it down twice. I told one of them, I said, you try to close it down, and I bet you I'll turn the place upside down, and I'll put a piece of paper and get all the veterans that feel like they need to come to be there. I don't know whether any of y'all on the board up there. Larry may know something about that.
Yeah. You've been the backbone of the office, Nick, and we appreciate your service over there.
Well, I didn't want to bug nobody. I always worked in the background, you know.
Very effective job, too.
I appreciate y'all.
Thank you, Mr. Thank Collins. You.
Okay, next we have a public hearing on a right-of-way closing. Jason?
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, good morning.
Good morning.
As you'll probably recall, at your last meeting, you passed a declaration of intent to close a portion of right-of-way along Carolina Road that we had received a petition for, and also to set the public hearing for today. Pursuant to North Carolina General Statute 153A-241, a notice of public hearing was posted in two places along the affected right-of-way. A notice of the public hearing along with a plat of the proposed changes was sent by certified mail to the property owners affected. And then we also advertise this once a week for three straight weeks in the Burlington newspaper. The proposed road closing that you're hearing today is actually abandoned right-of-way that was abandoned by North Carolina Department of Transportation several years ago, and it is where the travel way for Carolina Road once existed. The proposed closing would not affect the road as it is now. It would stay the same. This is just a piece of right-of-way that has been abandoned, and in order to be able to build on top of that or anything, it has to be combined back with the property owners. And with your package, you do have a copy of the plat and then also a copy of the resolution to actually officially close this portion of the right-of-way. And also, just to announce as well, should the board choose to close that portion of the right-of-way, any aggrieved person, by the closing of the portion of abandoned right-of-way, may appeal the order to an appropriate division of General Court of Justice within 30 days after the order is adopted. And with that, I'll be glad to take any questions you all have at this time.
Anyone that would like to speak to this?
I would.
Yes, sir.
Appreciate the opportunity to be here. I won't take up an enormous amount of your time because I can see you're very busy. I've been at Carolina Christian Church for the past 4 years, and in that period of time, we've doubled, a little more than doubled in size. And so we had looked at the possibility of maybe trying to expand buildings on our property to incorporate possible youth facility, possible facility for the senior members of our community and of our church. And we didn't want to get the cart before the horse, proverbially speaking, so we thought we better look at surveys and property lines, and found out that this right-of-way existed on the property. And though we could expand, it would certainly help us to be able to do that more efficiently if we had the access to this abandoned right-of-way. So in the process of that, we sought to file the proper documentation to bring that to this point today to see if that was a possibility, so we could hopefully move forward and allow our church to continue to grow as God would have will it and see fit. Thank you.
Any other comments? If not, we'll close the public hearing.
You got one.
Excuse me.
This proposal that before you today, I'm Tommy Murray. A section of this road bed is our front yard, and the Holsenbachs live next to us. Most of that road bed is their front yard. We have a section of the city property that was there that the city has already awarded to us. And with the church and the road bed and our property and all, which has been abandoned since the late 40s, we applied to have this property turned over to us. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any else? Okay, if not, do we have a motion?
Motion.
Second.
Motion second for discussion. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Next is the Rural Operating Assistance Program.
As you all know, every year the county applies for rural operating assistance funding from North Carolina Department of Transportation. And this year, underneath that is the elderly and disabled transportation assistance, as well as rural general public transportation, and also the Employment Work First program funding for that for through Wheels to Work. This application that we are filing includes both the regular funding that we get every year, as well as an additional supplemental amount under each program. In your packets, you should have a breakdown of that, of the funding that we are applying for, as well as a sub-allocation worksheet that was approved by the active board which would sub-allocate the EDTAP funding between Department of Social Services, Friendship Center, and the other agencies on there that that receive benefits under that program. And I know Dennis Williams from ACTA is here today as well to answer any questions, as well as I'll be glad to take any questions from y'all at this time as well.
Okay. Anybody in the audience like to speak to this? Hearing none, do we have a motion to accept it?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Thank you, Jason. Mr. Smith, you got anything?
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, just two things I wanted to announce. Brian Haygood is here, but the Glencoe Park that we've been hearing about is set to have an opening date of October 4th. Brian was able to get a $330,000 grant to help purchase this land to finish the park out there, and I think we're working on some more. Is that right, Brian?
Yes, sir.
And he and Roger Cobb, our ag agent, are also working on the Buster Sykes property, about 150 acres, and getting that ready for recreational use also. So we're moving ahead on those two parks. And that's all I have, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Smith, back on July the 16th, I was told that that the health department, that investigation, there were no criminal charges that would be made. However, some policy procedure changes, and at that time you and I had discussion, it was my understanding that the two employees at the health department would be reinstated. And why hasn't that occurred?
Some additional problems have arisen, and an new investigation is underway, Commissioner.
A new investigation?
Yes, sir. I don't know whether the sheriff wants to respond to it or not. I have nothing to do with that, but more investigation is going on.
Sheriff, do we have another criminal investigation going on?
Let's say there's some issues that we are dealing with right now, and I would rather not say of a criminal nature, not targeted at anybody within the health department, but things pertaining to the health department.
Well, we're paying these two employees if they're out of work. Why can't they just go back to work, Sheriff?
That's not my call. Well,
Judge, why can't they just go back to work?
I mean, is this probably new investigation, is it with the medical director and her assistant?
I wished we would address this on the 18th when everything is complete.
But in the meantime, we've got two employees that are being paid. They're not working.
That is not my call, Commissioner.
Well, it's up to the health director, Commissioner, as to whether or not they go back to work in the Board of Health.
He's here today. And I think I read somewhere in the paper that they're not working has made you short, you know.
That would be a fair statement, sir.
All right. So you need them back then. Would that be a fair statement?
That would be a fair statement if there are no problems.
So in other words, you don't have a problem with things just like they are right now.
I'd rather have folks working that are hired to work, yes, sir.
I think I'd rather see them working, too.
Who assumed their duties?
They're not getting, I guess, one of our part-time folks now, we've moved her up and to do more work than she was contacted to do.
When are you going to make a decision, Mr. Bassett, on reinstating them? If there are no criminal charges against them, why aren't you going to reinstate them?
I serve on that committee. Let me answer for him. I'm not going to answer for you, but I'll answer for myself. Serving on the health board committee, the health board don't want to put those people back to work until we have a full disclosure of what has been done and what is being done. We'd like to wait to the end of the investigation before we do anything or get those people back to work.
To answer the commissioner's question about my position on it, I'm supposed to get a report from the SBI tomorrow on the investigation that has proceeded so far, which I understand there are no prosecutable offenses that have been found. That's the word that I have gotten in the shorthand. I will know more tomorrow morning when I meet with the SBI, and I will report to the chairman of the health board and to the director of public health over there.
Anything else, Mr. Smith?
No, sir.
Any staff? Okay, we're down to the consent agenda.
Will you pull B, C, and D, please?
Okay. I'll pull B, C, and D. That leaves items A, E, F, and G. We have a motion to approve those. Please. Second it. Any discussion on those? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Okay. Item B, personnel policy amendment.
Yes, I want to question that. Joyce is here. Is this done in committee or individually on these changes? Personnel committee, or was it done with just within your office?
That was a discussion that we had. When I say we, Mr. Smith had a discussion with Mr. Sharp regarding the fact of the trying to reduce the cost for the county for covering retirees. So effective July 1 of 2008, the decision was made that we would not cover retiree benefits for an employee that was in effective July 1, 2008, that will not affect pre-existing employees that are working for Alamance County.
Okay,
we passed that in the budget.
That was actually passed.
But I'm having a problem with it because we have an employee hired after offer 08, and you want them to be loyal to Alamance County, and they work 20 years or 30 years, and then you cut them loose, kick them to the curb with no health insurance. And there will be a lapse between when they decide to retire, if that's the case, and Medicaid. I don't know that, you know, how do we expect employees to be loyal to us if we're not going to look out for their best interest?
I can't comment on the loyalty piece, but what I can say is, now we looked at other counties. Other counties are going to this because it is a cost-effective move. Not only that, when you look at private sector, this is not a practice that is practiced in private sector, but other surrounding counties for a more cost-effective approach are going to this approach.
This was already passed. It is on the agenda today because we were trying to get the personnel policy in line with the budget that you passed in May.
Right. I understand that.
It's the only reason it's on the agenda.
And then,
and we went over this issue at that point. Our retiree health insurance is costing the citizens of Alamance County this past year over $1.5 million. We have 850 employees full time now. I don't know what that is projected to be in 5 years, but I can assure you it's going to be over $2 to $2.5 million. That's 2 to 2.5 cents on the tax rate. No private business is doing that now, and most counties are having to get out of that because of the cost. And I don't see any reason, and I explained it to the board when I presented the budget, I don't see any reason why the citizens of Alamance County should have to pay that and carry that burden any longer. The employees who are employed as of June 30 are still covered. All new employees as of July 1 will not receive those benefits in 25 or 30 years.
And there's nothing that we can do, even on a percentage basis, between the time they retire and hopefully they are able to get Medicaid?
Medicaid, hopefully they'll get Medicare if they're 65 years of age. Yes, ma'am.
So you have that lapse in time there?
There are some who do have a lapse in time, yes, ma'am.
Okay, the second issue I had on the travel policy, if I read this correctly, you're saying receipts are not required for meal reimbursement. I'm going to have to say I feel very strongly that we should have receipts for any reimbursement, whether it's meals or whatever.
Well, what we do on that, Commissioner, is that the county up to this point has allowed a per diem of $30. We have broken it down. I think it's $8 for breakfast, $10 or something for lunch, and the rest for dinner. The bookkeeping can get just ridiculous. So long, but the county is only going to pay the $30. That's it. And however you, if you want to spend it all on dinner, then you spend it all on dinner. If you want to spend it all on breakfast, then fine.
David,
if you're going for the entire day, you get the $30.
Well, the way I read this, it's not $30, it's $45
per day. What I'm doing is asking that the board raise the $30 to $45 and use the same principle. Actually, the city of Burlington is $75. But if you take a trip nowadays, I'm sorry, it's hard for anybody to live on $30 a day. Breakfast going to cost you over $10, and most hotels and places that you go is where these conferences are. So that the only thing we're asking for on that issue is to raise the per diem to $45 rather than the $30, and the employee can spend that $45 on whatever meal they want.
Without a receipt?
Yes, ma'am.
I feel strongly you're asking for fraud there. I'm sorry. And I disagree with that.
Let me say something about travel without belaboring it too bad. I want to compliment our county manager on what he has done with scrutinizing some of the travel expenses. And I want to compliment Amy on putting together a pretty comprehensive report on travel. Back when we started looking at this, if I'm not mistaken, I think we went back. Didn't we go back 5 years, even before the county manager? Every year it was approaching $400,000. Every year. And when we looked at this fiscal year, when we took a snapshot of it at that point in time, it was on track to do it again. And here we came in with a fiscal year end at $314,000. So it appears that the travel category has been cut at least 20%. It appears that it did drop. And this is, it was kind of interesting to see what I saw in something that Clyde provided. Clyde got me some information from Beaufort County on some immigration ordinances that they had passed, and so I was flipping through them yesterday, and one of the packets of information that he provided, I'm surprised you didn't mention it to me, on the September 12th meeting, 2007, Beaufort County, they provided for the commissioners to vote yes or no on a travel set of travel expenditures. Each department had to list who the traveler was, what the dates were going to be, the location of where they were going, what the purpose of the trip was, and whether it was mandatory or desired. They had all those categories. Now, a category that they didn't have that I thought would be apropos to all this would be expense, what it would cost. And I saw, you know, like one of the listings was the sheriff there going out to Colorado claiming that it was mandatory. Maybe so. But I compliment us on what you've done with scrutinizing travel. But I think we need to do a better job even. And because when I looked at that list, I mean, it was hard to make heads or tails out of who's doing what and what the purpose is, whether it's mandatory, whether it's something they would just like to do. And frankly, I would have to leave it up totally to each department head to make those decisions. And I hope that we'll keep some type of analysis.
We do have a new form that we just started on, which does ask the department head to tell how, what the travel is. What else is it, Joyce?
What the travel is.
And the cost.
And the cost. And we asked for backup for all of that prior to them going to the travel, to the where their destination.
It has to be. Has to be, yeah.
It comes to me, I look at it, and then from there, I send it to the county manager. Right. And if they do not have backup, and if it doesn't add up and make sense, I return it.
Right. And what about mandatory versus desired? Do we make any decision or analysis of whether something's mandatory for credits or versus something they would just like to do because they think it would help them on their job?
No, a lot of the, particularly if there are say positions where they have to go for a certification, right, or if it's something like that, that's considered mandatory.
Right.
If the request looks a little, if it's not clear, and the department heads that are here know, I will call them and ask them, what is this? Or can I, and a lot of times they do a very good job. They provide the registration, which tells the purpose of where they're going, what it's for. So that kind of helps out. So since we have been doing this practice, and keep in mind, I haven't been privy to it prior to a couple of months that we've started this, everything I have seen has been justifiable. And if it's not, we don't approve it. So they know that.
Okay. Well, I want to add to that, and do appreciate what Amy has done on the travel for 0708. I did put it on a spreadsheet. And I think only one or two departments went over their budget, one by $2.67, and I won't mention which department that was. But most everybody really cut back on what was budgeted for travel, and that was a difference of $209,000. And I really commend these department heads for what they did, well below budget, and so congratulations. Thank you.
Well, it's amazing that we could have had $209,000 more than $300,000 in the budget. So yeah. I hope we keep a heck of an eye on this going forward. I believe we have done it.
It's almost $250,000 there.
Exchange of firearms?
Yeah.
You want to get that?
Yeah. Please.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to have a word before I forgot something I was going to say.
Okay.
I meant to tell you what the economy gets out of the Veterans Office here. 30-some million dollars this year comes into this county. This is what the office does through the girls right there. And it's been bringing millions in here ever since we first started. And to start off with, so we're not a lost cause. And that's the reason I appreciate, again, the judge so much for having me and listening to me the day that he listened to me, and I gave him my shortfalls about what was happening. We was like orphans. That's right.
Okay, I think I need to address Major Parrish. Okay. On the handout that we had in our packet. Okay. First, I can only assume, and I don't like to do that, on your sheet where you listed everyone, you have a yes column, no column. I'm assuming that was yes, they want their gun, weapon, mm-hmm. Or no, they don't.
Correct.
And then they will pay for it if they take that.
If the individual entity desires to purchase the weapon, then he will or she will bear the transaction will be conducted through the law.
Okay.
Not through the sheriff's office.
Then one other thing, I like the one sentence, the balance of $28,000 will be paid from federal seized assets.
Yes.
Very good. I appreciate that, but I do want to caution not just your department, but everybody in the times that we are going into and things are getting tight with the people, that we try not to spend if it's not necessary. And I know this is necessary. I'll say that up front. But when things are not absolutely necessary, if you can hold back your spending for the time being, I think it would be better. But good job here.
Thank you. Okay, I make a motion that we approve items B, C, and D.
Second.
Any further discussion? Not all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
Okay.
Any announcements?
I think Sheriff Johnson wants to address us.
Sir?
Ms. Sharp, certainly I'm not up here to be argumentative on anything, but you said something a while ago that sort of slapped me in the face that I had told the commissioners one thing and did another. Let me tell you, Alamance County Sheriff's Department has not profiled, and that's, I think that's where you were coming from, profiled anybody. Matter of fact, if you'll go to Department of Justice, North Carolina Department of Justice in Raleigh, I had Mr. Tony Queen at Sheriff's Conference come up to me, said he had two senators that asked him, or a senator to ask him, how many car stops we did of the Hispanic population. And he said, when I pulled it, he said, I was floored. He said, y'all do less down there than any county your size in this state. I don't know what you meant by, I said, we do one thing, we're doing another. I'd like to know what that is so I can address that, because I think, in a way, I was called a liar in here, Commissioner Sharp, and I didn't appreciate that.
Well, I don't know if you are or not profiling, Sheriff.
But you said we were doing things we told y'all we wouldn't do. Well, and that's all I want to know. What is
that stop on the highway?
Sir.
What were they doing?
They run the tag. The tag didn't belong on the vehicle. We have armed robbers every day switching tags. They, when they did the vehicle stop, found there was no insurance. The lady didn't have a license. If it had been a citizen American here, the exact same thing would happen. And the only way social services would have come and got those kids if they were neglected or abused. And the woman was demanding that the children stay with the adult in the car with her who went to church with her. Now, what would the newspaper have said if we would have forcibly took those kids out of that car instead of leaving them there? The woman also said that the husband lived on Mebbin Street in Burlington and would be there shortly, and the husband didn't even live in the state. What was the officer supposed to do? Tell me. I want to know.
Sheriff, let me interject here, please.
Sheriff's car not come by all night on the...
Sir?
Follow up on that.
The truth was not told by the people.
Like y'all would have followed up on that.
Sir, I'm telling you.
Leaving three
people
kids.
Come by there. The truth wasn't told in that deal. It was a situation that some of the media, wanted to jump on the Sheriff's Department. But let me say this. If you want Alamance County to go to a good old boy attitude where we do selective law enforcement, then you need to get another sheriff. Secondly, we're not going to show favoritism. We're going to, we enforce law. I don't make the laws, Commissioner Sharp, and I agree. Something needs to be done in Washington, D.C. But until that is done, I can't turn and am not going to turn my head on violations of the law. When you steal someone's identification and use it, then you have committed a felony by state law, by federal law, when it comes to Social Security number. What a lot of people, and ain't nobody wrote about it yet. I had a lady come in my office that went to Social Services, and I called Susan Osborne about it, wanting to get, she hadn't worked since 1997. Social Services says, you made too much money. She said, what do you mean I made it? I haven't worked. Come to find out, somebody stole her, and it wasn't a Social Security number, and was working out of Asheville, North Carolina, and this lady can't even get services now. That's the kind of stuff that I'm faced as sheriff. Can I turn my back on it? I'm certainly not trying to be disrespectful to you, but I'm asking you and the commissioners to look at my side. If you don't want me to enforce the law, then let's change the laws. But as long as they're on the book, my hand went on the Holy Bible, I'm going to do that. And do I agree with everything that's going on in this country? Absolutely not.
Sheriff, may I say something while you calm down?
Yes, ma'am. I'm not. You ain't seen me mad.
Yes, I have. You want to bet? Explain to us, because this is what we hear, and I don't know about the other commissioners. I speak for myself. This is what I hear. How did the deputy know that that was an illegal tag on that car when it's done in the middle of the night? It's
when you're riding down the road, and by George, my deputies better do this too, and you see something that's not right, you call in tag number, etc. Suspicious. It could be crossing the yellow line. It could be speed. It could be a lot of things.
The interstate?
Huh?
How can you do that on the interstate? Weren't they caught on the interstate?
See, I mean, we enforce the law on the interstate.
I know.
What are you saying?
How could the deputy tell that was an illegal tag when it was done on the interstate and cars are flying?
You call in on the radio, CCOM runs it gives you the make, model of the car and who it belongs to. And if it's on a Chevrolet and that tag belongs on a Cadillac, that's a fictitious registration or an invalid registration. That is a violation of North Carolina law.
That's the first thing you do. I've been a police officer. First thing you do is you
when you stop somebody or getting ready to look at them.
But you call for your safety.
Why was they suspicious to him in the first place?
I think the car passed him.
Oh,
moving on.
Okay, because that's where I was trying to get to. Okay, now another issue, and you weren't in here, I don't believe, when Mr. Shue came up and talked, and he talked about the children on the highway. Of course, you had no way of knowing. But again, couldn't someone have checked? I mean, with vehicles going up and down the interstate.
I don't think it was no 8 o'clock in the morning before the daddy got there.
Or later. Okay. Several years ago, I don't remember whether someone was killed or someone was injured because there was a stop on the interstate. A deputy took whoever down to Graham and left at least one person still in the vehicle. Mr. Shue was correct. And that car got hit.
Got rear-ended.
Right. Can we, I don't know what your policy is, and it may be, can't we change that policy that nobody is left on the interstate? Take them wherever, and yeah, you'll be under attack, but at least they won't be injured.
You tell me, hey, I ain't going with you. If you ain't arresting me, I ain't going nowhere. How can I take you? That's kidnapping. That's false imprisonment. And these are things we run into. And believe me, a lot of the people on the street are much more knowledgeable of the law just about as law enforcement. They know what they can and can't do, what we can do and what we can't do. And in that situation, they demanded to stay there with the car. We can't tow the car. Somebody's with it. So, I mean, I wish you would look on the law enforcement right now. I can make a whole lot of policy and wind up in federal court. And I'm not going to do that. We have a policy procedure manual that I'll be glad to give every commissioner here to look at that covers just about every situation again. But there's some that we can't. For instance, if I go to his house, he's the granddaddy, he's got kids, and somebody wants me to take them, I can't take them unless there's abuse and neglect or some reason there. And if I do, then I'm just as guilty as if I went there and kidnapped them. And that's what we're faced in law enforcement.
Well, I'm going to take you up on that offer of a policy manual. I would really like to see it. I don't know how to answer the public's questions when I get questioned.
I understand.
And I really would.
I'd like to end by just saying, Ms. Sharp, please, I respect you highly. But what have we done that we said we wouldn't do? That's what bothered me more than anything. Because I have been so strenuous on our people to make sure we follow the law and try to do what's right. If I wanted to just drag somebody in, the guy that come down to sheriff's office the other day, well, I don't have that authority. But if you're gonna come to Alamance County,
you got deputies that have that authority though.
No, sir. ICE has to do that. What a lot of people don't understand about 287G program, and this is where the media has really told the public a lie. The only way you get processed under the 287G program is if you come to jail on another violation and you are foreign born. That's it. Now, ICE has the authority, if Ms. Vaughn is here illegally, to go out and just scarf her up if they want to. Well, I don't control ICE. I want you to understand that. I do not control ICE. But where there's a criminal violation, Commissioner Sharp, we're not going to turn our back on it. I know you don't expect us to, but I want you to understand everything the Alamance County Sheriff's Department has done has followed what exactly I told the commissioners the Alamance County Sheriff's Office would do. Now, these violations of identity theft and things, I can't turn my back on that, and I'm not going to. I don't care if it was Tim Sutton, Larry Sharp, or Dan Engel, and that's all we're trying to do. So, please, if you've got any questions, please come to the sheriff's department and look.
Okay, if you stop someone and give them a ticket, mm-hmm. a Hispanic, mm-hmm. what do you do?
If there's, which is just like we do with America, if they're DWI, they go to jail. If they're no operator's license, they come to the jail. If they're careless and reckless, they come to the jail. If they just speed, they get a citation, go on. Now, if they don't have a license, they're going to be charged no other operator's license and come to jail.
See, that's the whole situation.
You get treated just like the citizens
exactly.
of the United States.
Okay. Well, I'm glad to
we're
hear that.
We're just enforcing the damn law is what we're that. Doing.
But the general impression is you've got...
But who has done that? The media has done that.
Your jail sales up over there to bring income in.
Listen, we've got enough over in our jail. We don't have to arrest
general impression.
Sure.
But that, excuse me, let me say something here. I apologize, Ann, but let me say something. Part of what the sheriff is being criticized for is the mode of attack of the people who don't want to do anything on this, and they're trying to shoot down 287G, and they're reaching out for the stat that's out there that the majority of the people that are being put in the jails through 287G is a result of traffic offenses. Okay, and I would say rhetorically to anybody, what in the world does anybody expect you to do with somebody who has no tag on their car that matches the car, no insurance, no ID, you
and
have
lie about their name,
no idea who they are,
what the lady did,
let alone whether they're drunk or not, give them a ticket? Now that is laughable. Up at Fort Dix in New Jersey, I think it was Fort Dix, they had some illegal aliens that drove pizza trucks that worked for a pizza place. And they had access to the base because they delivered pizzas. Their goal, they had automatic weapons that had been given to them by the government that were unusable. And they were just going to see how far they were going to take their plot. They were going to go on that base and go into mess halls and barracks and literally kill soldiers as an act of terrorism. Now, this happened within 12 months ago. They found out that those illegal aliens, first of all, they were illegal, and found out that they had been in touch with the police. The police had actually had their hands on them a collective total of over 50 times. And a majority of those offenses were traffic offenses. You had the Duke computer programmer killed by an illegal alien down in Durham at 8 o'clock in the morning. He was going to work. I don't know where the illegal alien was going. You had Dr. Fetterman, who was head of the pharmacy school at Campbell University, where I went to school. He and his wife had gone to Raleigh for her birthday party. And were on their way home. And he called their children. He said, we're tired. We're going home and we're going to rest. We had a good time in Raleigh. An illegal alien took off the driver's side half of their van and killed them. And I guarantee and countless stories of this across the state and nation. And I guarantee you won't talk to a relative of any of those people. And thank the Lord they stopped the plot at Fort Dix. But you won't talk to a soul in those families that won't look you square in the eye and say, I wish that 287G had been in that county to have stopped what did take place later, what graduated up to a worser crime. Now, it's management of this nation. That's what it's all about. And if it offends people, I am sorry. But I don't think we had any idea that we had such traffic offenses going on out here. With drunk. I mean, you had a case in this morning's paper where a person was drunk with their child in the car. And I don't know if they were illegal or not, but you have drunk drivers and you have people that do things that are legal, obviously. I mean, they're legal and they do things that are bad. But you would have less of this going on if we had a better handle on that, on this. This is what the sheriff's trying to do, and I fully support what we're doing. And I'm sorry, Ann, that I jumped in on that. But I just
well, okay. Right. We've talked about this enough, I think.
May I? Well, I wanted to ask a question, Sheriff. What is your policy on using interpreters?
We have five individuals, the Alamance County Sheriff's Office, that speaks Spanish languages. We get access to them when we need them.
On call. Mm-hmm. I don't know what's in your policy book, policy and procedures, but couldn't we,
hire more,
not in there,
give them a position.
Have it in there that when they speak another language, hopefully it was going to be Spanish if we only have Spanish interpreters, that that they're called, even if it's 2 o'clock in the morning?
Well, the
telephone call, because...
The daughter spoke English with the officer, and if we'd have needed one, you know, if she couldn't have spoken, she certainly would have got an interpreter after.
I know, Sheriff, but my point is this. She spoke to the mother to ask her mother if it was okay, and the mother shook her head, but she spoke to the mother in Spanish. I don't know Spanish. I doubt your deputy knows Spanish. Where I feel that we need an interpreter. We don't need to depend on a child or a third party. She could have been asking her mother, are you coming back? And the mother's going, mm-hmm. You know.
Yeah, but the daughter was talking to the officer, giving the answers that the officer was asking the mother. See, the whole story on this hadn't been told.
Yeah.
correctly. But also, Ms. Sharp, I know that you'll be leaving the board, but I want you to understand, I appreciate everything you've done as commissioner. I want you to understand that. And I certainly wasn't here to bash or argue with you. I just, you know, the problem is the media has blown so much out of proportion, just like the young man that come down the other day. When he left, he was shocked, and he understood the change has to be in Washington, D.C., not in Alamance County. But as long as I'm sure, you know, we're going to enforce the law here. And all I can say to the people, if they don't want that, then I'll go home, you know. I don't need the headaches. Thank you.
What's the condition of the gentleman that was injured in the fight in the jail? Where the three guys jumped on him?
He's okay. He's doing okay. Yes, sir.
I heard he got a broken back or something. That's nothing to that.
I think that was the media again.
Yeah, the media again. But I think. But see, that's something else we're running to, Commissioner Sharp, is we're arresting gang members out here for other violations and not knowing which gang they belong to, and they go into the jail, and, buddy, it's tough. I'm telling you, it's tough. As far as filling the jail, we can fill that jail where we have one ICE prisoner or not. I can, you know, I tell you that, and I want you to please understand that. And
I had another question that I meant to ask the major, and I'll ask you since you're standing up here. Are you ordering extra weapons? When these weapons are ordered, because you would be hiring new personnel coming into the...
Yes, ma'am, I think for six,
we ordered seven. A total of 150. We have 137 sworn
right.
People, so we have
okay. 15. And see, when an officer retires at the Sheriff's Department, they can apply for their weapon at retirement, and we honor. Gibbons County has always done that. But thank you all of y'all very much for your consideration.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
And you have something?
Yes. I was privileged to be invited, and I think all of us were, but I did go to the Junior Police Academy graduation on Saturday evening at the Ramada, I believe. If you ever have the opportunity to have one of your children involved in that program, or someone you know that needs some help involved in that program, Sheriff Johnson was also there and received one for his department. I was amazed. I'm thinking, okay, how do I get my grandkids involved in this next summer? It is a 4 week long program. They do stress a lot. It's like they go through boot camp. What could be better? I have a lot of respect. I was amazed at what I saw. They did have a fantastic video they showed, and I asked if we couldn't get that here to show excerpts of it. They may do it by the 18th. It was very professionally done, very nicely done. I think all law enforcement in this county that is involved in that program. It takes a lot. The kids really benefit. I was amazed. They stress several things: aiming, believing, surviving, and succeeding. The Junior Police Academy of 08. You'd be very proud. I'm proud to have accepted this. Can we place it in this room? I don't know.
And we, we've stored a lot of the things that we had on the walls around here. We'll place it somewhere.
They actually spent a weekend at Elon University. I mean, you know, the structure and the marching, and it's really a good program, great program.
It's excellent. And if you can see the video and see what those youngsters
strive to do from the start to the finishes, it's like going through boot camp and coming out on the other side as a Marine or whatever.
It's tough.
Yeah. I watched that video. It's where tough. It's going,
it is tough.
And the Vines, I think, knows something more about it.
I'd just like to say that, you know, this program is a good program, and, you know, the Alamance County Farm Bureau, we've participated in this. We have sponsored and helped, you know, with this program in the past, and we're going to continue on this. As we do on many projects here in the county with youth, you know, it's important to us. We support the DARE program, you know, as well. But it is a good program, and I would challenge each and every business and whatever out here in this community to help involve in this, because they do have problems getting funding. You know, this is private. This is not something that's done by the county or the state or whatever. I just wanted to say that.
Thank you, Mr. Pines.
Just want to give an update on the NACO prescription discount card program that that we started back in January. Through June, 12,437 prescriptions have been filled by using the discount drug program for a total savings of $132,000 to the citizens who are using those cards. So it seems to be working well. Hopefully we're keeping the drugstore stocked with application cards.
They
but
call quite frequently.
Okay, good.
They are replenished.
Yeah, well, good. But that's on NACO's website. Okay, anything else? Have any other motions?
I'd like to move we go into closed session. Personnel issue.
I got to go to work. Okay. So, yeah, I'll sit back.
Do we have a second?
Nobody wants to discuss personnel.
Yeah, you have
a reason.
Law.
Law.
I'll second it, but you got to give a state a reason to go into closed session and state the statute or whatnot.
I don't know the statute. Why? What statute?
Yes, you do.
Do you know the statute?
150.
Off the top of my head. Is it personnel matter? State by statute. That exception, the statutory exception for
personnel issue. Okay, there's a motion, a second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carried.
Wait, Major, can I see
that'd be important.
I am under subpoena to be a grand jury.
I won't be.